Tonight, we are going to talk about a subject that I think is going to be really, really helpful. Hopefully, you will find it as well. And it's called the Biblical Theology of the Old Testament. Now, before I do that, let me make this diagram up on the board that will hopefully bring everything to a full circle. And this is that triangle that we talked about early in our series. On one end is literature. By literature, we're not talking about magazines and books. By literature, we're talking about the Bible is a book of literature, of course, has genres and has syntax and semantics. We studied this in great depth, and it was very hard for some of you to understand because, you know, we try to forget grammar. We're not trying to remember grammar, but it's something that is critical to understand. Then we looked at history. History of the Bible. We talked about the different kingdoms that came, and geography of the Bible, politics, religion in the Old and the New Testament that people of God had to deal with. Tonight we begin something that completes this triangle, and for the next 2-3 weeks, Vacation Bible School, we're not going to have our Bible study because all this will be taken up. But this is the third point that completes the triangle of biblical interpretation, which is theology. Literature, how the Bible is written. History, what all happened and what was happening when the Bible was being written. And then theology, which is something we're going to learn tonight, and hopefully you will see how it all comes together. So if you have your notes with you, let's begin to walk with it. Why is it needed? Why is biblical theology of the Old Testament needed? It is needed to help keep the study of the Old Testament from being fragmented by biblical exegesis. Now, what do I mean by that? Fragmented. If all we do is focus on literature, and all we do is focus on history, we lose sight of the big picture. If all we're talking about is how Moses wrote the book of Genesis, and how it is a narrative, and how David wrote the Psalms, and how it's a song, and how Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John wrote the Gospels, and it's a biography. If all we do that, we're missing something. And if all we do is talk about how the Mesopotamians and the Babylonians and the Egyptians and the Canaanites, if all that we're talking about them, we're also missing something very important. In fact, sometimes you have to step back and see the whole forest. Does that make sense? You're so focused on the trees, you cannot see the whole forest. This helps us see the whole forest. This helps us see the rest of the picture, see the whole drama of God's redemption. That's what's happening here. So, why is it needed? To help keep the study of the Bible, the Old Testament, from being fragmented by biblical exegesis, to describe the inner unity of the Bible on its own term. So we get the literature, we get the history, but how do they all work together? Now, I can guarantee you, many of you already know some of these things. Tonight, I'm not going to be teaching you something brand spanking new, but I'm going to give you reasons why what you may think is the unity may not be the unity, or what you may be thinking is the unity, but these are the reasons why you can say, oh, this is what's going on in the grand scheme of things. Does that make sense? So we're kind of not necessarily brand new stuff, but this puts it all together. Is another thing, to deepen our understanding of the shape, complexity, and unity of Scripture on its own terms. It is one thing to say, I mean, let me tell you what's happening in the Bible. I'll tell you what's happening in the Bible is God is showing us his love. Now, I can say that all day long. I need to back it up. Why do I say that? On what basis? Well, I just see it. I mean, God shows his love. I mean, he made us. We get that. Back it up. Show me some scriptures where it says that God is showing his love. Well, what God is doing is he is showing us his majesty. You know, some people get really caught up in that. All you see through the Bible is God's majesty. Well, where do you see it? Well, it's all over. Where? Well, I mean, the way he made the creation. Well, show me the verse. Because all it's saying is, let there be, let there be, let there be. I mean, I don't see him trying to just show his majesty all the time. There's more to it. So sometimes people say things, and I've seen some great preachers and teachers do that too, and I'm going, is that all the Bible is about? Show me. Tonight you're going to learn why you can say certain things and why it is not good to say those things and have some reasons, and the reasons are right in front of you. So this whole idea of biblical theology, the history of biblical theology, began in 1787. It was a speech given by a German scholar by the name of John Philip Gabler. And he is the first one who came around and said, there is something called biblical theology. Biblical theology. Now, keep in mind, this third end of the triangle is not just biblical theology. There's other theologies I'm going to bring in the next 2-3 weeks, okay? But biblical theology. Prior to this, everything was dogmatic theology. Who is God? How has he spoken? What is salvation? What is justification? What is atonement? What is eschatology? What is ecclesiology? I mean, on and on and on. And there are some very thick books out there, volumes upon volumes. How many? Tens of thousands and thousands of them. But many of them were simply argument after argument about why somebody believes that this is what God is all about. Few verses thrown in. Again, I'm being very simplistic. This person came around and said, our theology, first and foremost, should come from the Bible. Now, please don't misunderstand. He was not necessarily a conservative, born again. I mean, I guess he was. But he was not trying to be any of that. All he was saying was, for too long, the church has been so caught up in dogmatic theology, it is time we did biblical theology. And again, I want to clarify, he was not trying to be an evangelist. He was just making a differentiation. Okay? The concept existed prior to it. He distinguished between biblical theology and systematic theology. So, now we come to this question. Is there a key to the Old Testament theology? So if when we say, let me tell you what the Old Testament is about. Is there something like that? Is there a key that we can pull out and say, this is what the Old Testament is about? We haven't even come to the New Testament yet, okay? Because then we're going to say, that's what the Old Testament is about. This is what the New Testament is about. And then together, this is what the Bible is about. I'm sure you've heard that before, right? This is what the Bible is about. This is what's happening in the Bible. Prior to Gabler, people did that, but not as much. It was simply systematic theology. People like Calvin, people like Aquinas, people like Augustine, they were just theologians, dogmatic theologians, just what is God? Well, they'll bring every philosophy, logic, Bible, put it all together. This is who God is. This is why we believe he exists. This is what he is doing in this world. Gabler and others said, put all that aside. Forget about dogmatics. Forget about systematic. Let's go to the Bible verse by verse and see who the Bible says God is. And it's sometimes it is shocking because you go, no, that's what I've always believed, and the Bible doesn't say that. And it kind of shakes you up. So biblical theology is very important. Tonight we're only focusing on what? The Old Testament biblical theology. Okay? So is there a key? Is there something that can unlock? Let me flip this triangle so I don't confuse you because the triangle is theology, but here we're focusing on Old Testament biblical theology. Is there a key? And if there is a key, were the Old Testament writers aware of this key? Because I can make a key all day and say, well, I'll tell you what the Bible is about. The Bible is about this. But if Moses did not know this, and if Isaiah did not know this, and if Malachi did not know this, now I'm not going to the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Paul, and all of them, just Old Testament tonight, then my key could be my opinion. So this key should be something that they could say, yes, yep, that's the key. That's the key. Folks, what we're doing here tonight, I would say 99% of churches, Christians, will never do. We're getting more precise. We're becoming more laser-like and more accountable in how we study the Bible. I think what's happened in today's world is people just make up opinions and say, I believe the Bible is this, and I believe the Bible is that. And I think this is what, and the reason I think Christianity is suffering because we got so many opinions. Everybody's got an opinion. What's the key? So, the key or center of Old Testament theology, by the way, I put it all in here, must satisfy four conditions simultaneously. I know these, it's too much of a hot day for you to use your brain tonight, but you're going to have to, okay? Four things make up a key. Four things. Number one, the subject of that unity must be everywhere in evidence throughout the whole Old Testament corpus. Subject. Okay? Who is the subject? Let me back this up. It needs a subject. Please don't lose heart. I'll explain this, go a little further. I know we're going deeper, but that's what the whole point is. It needs to have a subject, somebody who is in charge, somebody who is doing things. Of course, we know somebody would be God, all right? Okay. See, we know some things. It also needs an object to whom the action, plan, or ideas pertain also must be clearly in the limelight. Means it's not just enough to say, what God is showing is that he is love. To who? To whom? You cannot have just this abstract, God is just showing love, or God is just showing his holiness, or God is just showing his mercy. To whom? It's got to have an object. Are y'all catching on a little bit? A predicate, number three, if y'all are still with me, a predicate that links the subject and the object must be clearly stated in key teaching passages that acts as what is known as sedes doctrinae, which means chair passages. Folks, here's the thing. How many of y'all have been aware of some cults and movements, especially on TV? Golly, some of the stuff you see on TV, you go, how do they get 2,000 people or 20,000 people? What they do is they take this one tiny phrase or verse and they make a big doctrine out of it. Some obscure passage, and they make this big movement and crazy people follow it. And they say, this is the word. This is what God is doing in this world. And the question is, do you have a verse? Of course we do. In the book of Lamentations, chapter 4, verse 11. I just made that up, by the way. I don't know what it says. They're like, well, nobody knew that. So God took this great key and stuck it in the book of Lamentations, verse 4, chapter 4, verse 11, in this tiny little phrase. And that is what God has been doing. Really. One tiny obscure passage is driving your denomination, your movement, your church, your whatever you're doing. Something's wrong with that. So the key should not just be something stuck in a corner somewhere. God doesn't do that way. Number one, it needs a subject. Number two, it needs an object. It also needs a link. And where should this link be? Y'all help me with that, number three. It should be one of the chair passages. I mean, it should be a key passage. Or one of the key passages that set the grand goals and objectives for everything the subject is going to do, to be, and do for the object specified in the text. All Bible is the Word of God. But not all Scripture has the same value. For example, Genesis chapter 12 has a special value because this is where God gave that command to Abraham. Come, I'm going to take you to a place, and from you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. That's a very special passage. Hey, listen, are y'all listening? If that passage does not show this key, something is wrong. This key should show up in these key passages, or I've said it as chair passages, chair like a chairman. Number four, the linking of the first three conditions must set forth explicitly in the Old Testament rather than brought in from external sources such as philosophical grounds, historical considerations, theological preferences, or critical allegiances. What does that mean? It means, bottom line, it means this. It should come from the Old Testament passages. You cannot say, well, you know, my uncle used to say, or my favorite preacher used to say, or a book I read, or some New York Times bestseller, or some Puritan wrote back in the 1600s. I love Puritans, but I'm not going to make my key passage based on someone's opinion. It's got to come from the Bible. So the key should have a subject that is clearly visible. It should have an object also clearly visible. It should have a link. Linking the subject to the object, where? Just anywhere? No, in chair passages, key passages. And before you say, oh, that's the key, make sure you're not bringing in what? Philosophical grounds, historical considerations, theological preferences, critical allegiances. Folks, listen, I hope y'all catch this tonight. I know this is deep. History is important. Literature is important. But if I were to make that key based on something the Canaanites used to do, or if I were to base the key on some Egyptian literature from some, you know, sarcophagus, no. The key has to come from Scripture, not from all these side influences. Does that make sense? Y'all looking at me going like, yeah, why do you repeat yourself? Because many times, a lot of theologies are built this way. And there are whole denominations out there based on them. There are churches out there. There are books written based on these things. And it blows my mind how Christians eat it up because they're always looking for something new, something fresh, something like, oh, that's what we've been missing all these years. And it's like, if it's that new, more than likely, something's wrong with it. Something's wrong with it, okay? So going back over here. Hopefully this will start clicking for you, okay? So, again, this is my opinion. There's a writer by the name of Walter Kaiser who has done a lot of work on biblical theology, and I lean towards his view of biblical theology, especially how to determine the key. I lean towards it. I'm not completely sold out, but I lean towards it. At least he has a good working model. And this discussion is based on his writings. Who is the subject? According to Walter Kaiser, the subject is Yahweh, which is God. Everybody good on that? God. Who is the object? We're looking for the key to the Old Testament, okay? Who is the object? Israel is the object. First, primarily it's Israel. Isn't that what you see in the Old Testament? God is constantly working with his people Israel. After Genesis 12, the first 12 chapters, I mean, he is making things. He is cursing sin. And then, you know, he is destroying the world. Then he's working with Noah. And then the Tower of Babel, he is dispersing them. All that is done. Then begins Abraham. Starting in Genesis 12, the birth of the people of Israel. Abraham. The rest of the Old Testament, God is primarily working with Israel. But it's not just Israel, because what did I write here? Secondarily, all the nations of the earth. So it's not just Israel, but it's also the world. Nothing new. I mean, I didn't teach y'all anything new so far. You know this. And especially in our church, and if you've been to Bible-believing churches, you will not have a problem with any of this. You'll agree with it. What is the link? Its predicate involves both who and what God will be and what he will do in his verbal declarations and his mighty saving acts in the history of Israel. So its predicate involves both who and what God will be and what he will do. So it's all about him. Being and doing. Now, don't check out on me, because we're going somewhere with this. And this whole thing, God working with Israel first and then with the whole world, being something to them and doing something for them, is found strategically numerous times in the Old Testament in large blocks of teaching text. But the best place it's found in, right from the beginning, Genesis chapter 12, verses 1, 2, and 3. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn there. Genesis chapter 12, what does it say? Now the Lord had said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. Now comes verse 3. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. This is the key of the Old Testament. From here on, what God is doing every step of the way in every book is simply fulfilling what he told Abraham in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1, 2, and 3. Through you, I'm going to make a people, and these people will be a great people, and I will bless you, make your name great, and I will bless those who bless you, I will curse those who curse you, and in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Means someone or something is coming through you that's going to bless the world. This is the key. Some of y'all are saying, man, I wasted my time coming here tonight. I already knew that. Once you understand this and keep this in mind, it will keep you from going off tangent. We have a lot of tangents in Bible studies and messages, a lot of tangents. And they may sound very cool and they may sound really exciting and new and fresh, but if they don't stick with this, then you got the wrong key. Now, look at the next section. The terms that are used for this key, because it doesn't say in Genesis 12, 1 to 3, here is the key. It won't say that. In fact, you won't find that word anywhere there. What do you instead hear? You hear things like, here is my word to you. I have taken an oath. I have made a covenant, or I have built my house, or this is my kingdom. These are the words that are used. But they're all describing the key. Now, I told you this is only about the Old Testament, but let's jump into the New Testament briefly. What is used in the New Testament to describe this key? One word. What is that word? Promise. I'm so happy to see all y'all with me. I was wondering if I was losing you. The one word that is constantly used is the word promise. Let's try it out, okay? See if somebody can find Acts chapter 26, verse 6 and verse 7. If you find it, just go ahead and read it. See that promise? All right, another verse. Romans chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. Are y'all catching this? You see the promise, the promise, the promise. That's the Old New Testament word. I don't have time to look at all the references with the Old Testament word for key. Let's look at a couple more just to do it. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 13 through 15. I'm picking books by different authors so that you won't think only one person is using that word. Hebrews chapter 6, 13 through 15. You see that? Another word is the same thing. Promise is being mentioned repeatedly. Now, this is how the early church saw the Old Testament. The Old Testament was a book of promise. I wish they had kept it as a book of promise instead of the Old Testament, because many of us don't know what a testament is. You know what a testament is? It's really a covenant, which is the key. Right? All right? So, somebody turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 20, 38 and 39. This is Peter's speech on the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. If you find it, I'm sorry, 38 and 39. If you find it, just read it. There you go, promise again. On the day of Pentecost, Peter is saying, promise has come. The key. Folks, if we ignore this key and go to the Old Testament to find whatever pet doctrine we want, we will find it, but it has nothing to do with this key. And if all I did, let's go back here for a moment, if all I did was focused on the literature and the history, I will come up with wild and crazy stuff. Or I might even come up with accurate stuff, but I'm missing the big picture unless I put the key in. We will see that worked out in just a few moments, okay? Let's look at one more. Galatians chapter 3, verse 22. If someone can read that one for us. I just want this to kind of go into our minds. Promise. Okay? But also, the promise was not just to Israel, but also to the whole world. Now, I'm only going to the New Testament references because the Old Testament are so many. Let's look at Galatians 3:8. If y'all or somebody's there, if you can go ahead and read that for us. Because we sometimes think it was only between God and Abraham and God and the people of Israel or God and the Jewish people. Not true. This was for all people. Galatians chapter 3, verse 8. There you go. So even though the word promise is not used, the idea is, it's coming to you, Abraham, so you can give it to the whole nations. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. Somebody can read that for us. Speaking to the Ephesians, who, again, are part of the Gentile world, they also had this promise given to them. So the point of all this is that going back here, the key to the Old Testament, to understand the Old Testament, the key is this. God is the subject. Israel first is the object, but then through Israel, the rest of the world are also the objects. The link is God working in them, being someone for them, and promising something to them. Link, which we haven't looked at in the Old Testament, we simply looked at the New Testament ones. The Old Testament passages, we did not spend time looking at them because there are so many, but they need to be prominent passages. They need to be not coming from philosophy and history and theology and critical allegiances, but they're coming right from the Word of God. So how does this help? I think I've been saying this all along, but let me say it again. When you do this, go back over here. When you do this, in fact, Old Testament biblical theology is one aspect of theology. Then it's the New Testament. Then it's systematic. on and on. It's also other thing, but I don't have time to get into that. Canonical and other theologies. We're just studying this one tonight. It adds the necessary depth to the study and interpretation of each passage in its context. Based on where a person is studying in the Old Testament, the key or the center will help in shedding light on the text in a whole new way. What is that passage in, was it Jeremiah, where God promises them? What is that passage everybody loves? I preached on it. Right. The promise to, I preached on it so many times I just don't remember. Giving promise to a future and a hope and all of that stuff. If you just take that, and I think it's wonderful when graduates use that verse and Christians use it and we write it in Bibles, nothing in the world wrong with that. So don't you ever walk away saying, well, I guess it doesn't apply. It applies. But once you understand the key and you put the key on that passage, it takes on a much deeper meaning, okay? We're going to see that in just a few moments. In fact, you get a chance to given your input. All right, also, again, how does the Old Testament theology help in studying the Bible? It will open the understanding of the text in its proper, larger context of God's promise plan. This will prevent the student from running to the New Testament. Folks, are y'all seeing what I'm trying to do here? How often have you heard a message where you begin with a verse and the moment you're done with the verse, your people run immediately Romans or Galatians or Hebrews or Jesus said this in Matthew. They don't deal with the Old Testament first. Are y'all with me? They immediately go here, there, everywhere. It's like the verse does not have any oomph to stand on its own. The key keeps you from running here, there, everywhere, and stay on that Old Testament passage. That's why when I begin my messages, I always begin by reading, then I say something about bridging, how does this apply, and then I explain in the original context, this is what's happening. I don't run off immediately to Philippians and Colossians and Revelation and even Old Testament passages. Sometimes people even go off to another Old Testament passage as if this one can't stand on its own. The key keeps you on that passage and let that passage speak before you look for help to the New Testament or Old Testament or a story or an idea, or politics. Stay on that passage. Yes, sir. Yes. To help explain that, yeah. Yeah, the key helps you with that tremendously. Once you have the key, because it's like a big box of spices. You know, you're ready to cook a meal, and it's like, here's the meal, but let's go run over here and eat this first. And let's run over there and eat that. What are you going to do with this? Oh, it's going to taste so much better once you eat this and this and this. You see, nobody does that. We're like, no, we want to make this, whether it's hamburger or whether it's pork chop or whether it's whatever it is, man. Let's make this better. But we don't do that. When it comes to the Bible, we run everywhere else. Now, Walter Kaiser offers the following 7 stages of the promise. And it's in your handout, so you don't have to strain your eyes trying to look for this. What is the promise? Can someone say the promise for me? Put in your words. Yeah, the promise, the key. Can someone give me that key? God working with Israel first and the world. And what is the work? What is the work? Promise. Yeah, I'm here to save you, and ultimately I'm sending someone who's going to do that. That's the key. That's it. On the basis of that, you can divide the Old Testament into 11 sections. The first is what's known as the prolegomena to the promise, which is the pre-patriarchal period of the promise. This is Genesis chapters 1 through 11. And I've also added the book of Job to it, because to me the book of Job is probably the oldest book in the Bible. That falls in the category before God had even talked to Abraham about the promise. Then comes the second stage, which is provisions in the promise, which we read in Genesis 12, 1 to 3. Through you, I'm going to do this. And all the families of the earth will be blessed. Those who bless you, I will bless. Those who curse you, I will curse. End of that. How far does that go? The provision. End of the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 50, and then it stops. The next stage is the people of the promise, which shows up in the what's known as the Mosaic era. This is the book of Exodus. Now the people are in Egypt. They are in slavery. Moses shows up. He leads them out of Egypt. And he also does what? They're a bunch of slaves. On the night of the Passover, they become a people. People of the promise. And they're given laws and rules and sacrifices on how to be holy unto God. Numbers, it all falls in that same category. Place of the promise. Place of the promise. They were not just, you know, you're my people, end of story. One day someone's coming. No, they were taken to a place. What's that place? The promised land, Israel, land of Canaan. And then the book of Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, they deal with the land of the promise. Who comes after that? The king of the promise. The Davidic era. Ruth. Who was Ruth? Ruth was David's great grandmother, right? Yeah. Psalms. Do all the Psalms fall under the Davidic era? No, not all of them. Some of them do. Samuel, Chronicles, Kings. Life in the promise. This is the wisdom era. This is where you come across books like some Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. This is about how people of God can live until the promise comes wisely. How can they live wisely? Day of the promise. This is the 9th century prophets. People like Joel and Obadiah. They were from the 9th century. This is before the Assyrian exile. It means they're doing some bad stuff. But God hasn't kicked them out of the land yet. Folks, so here's my question. Y'all listening? They're doing some bad stuff. God hasn't kicked them out. But the key is still the same. Promise is coming. But there's going to be some discipline time. If you just open up the book of Joel and say, oh, this is what it says, and so the literature and the history, okay, I get it. But if you don't apply the key, God says, I'm going to give you what I promised you, but you're going to get some whooping. In fact, you're going to lose the land. And 10 of you tribes will never come back. If you don't have the key, all you see is hopelessness. The key keeps you grounded. All right, who comes next? The servant of the promise. These are the 8th century prophets. These are the ones in front of whom the exile is happening, some of them. Amos, Hosea, Micah, Isaiah, and Jonah. You know, Jonah was at the time when Assyria had this revival. Not spiritual revival, but they were revived as an empire. And Jonah is thinking, hey, finally we're winning. God, would you just destroy them? God is like, no, I got something for them too. See, if you don't have the key, you think like Jonah. Just kill them all, God. God says, no. I have a plan for Israel, but I also have a plan for them. I want you to go preach to them. Because that's also in the promise. And by the way, what would you have done if you were in Jonah's place? Folks, at least he went back. None of us would have gone back. We would have said, forget it, I'm not going. Renewal of the promise. These are the 7th century prophets. Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Nahum, Jeremiah, Lamentations means exile. The first exile has happened. The second exile is happening. Guess what they're thinking? I think God has changed his mind. The promise is not coming. When you have that key in your mind and then you read the book of Jeremiah, that's when you see there is so much hopelessness. Then comes the kingdom of the promise, which are the exilic era prophets, Esther, Ezekiel, Daniel. Now, Esther is not a prophet, but I put her there because I think she falls in that period. Kingdom of the promise. Let me ask you this. What kingdom did Daniel have? They lost it all. The northern kingdom is gone. The southern kingdom just got taken away. They are sitting in a foreign land. Right? Have to bow to this statue, and if you don't, you're going to be thrown in the fiery furnace. This is what's happening. The promise looks very distant. Would you have, can y'all help me tonight? Would you have said to the chief butler, we're going to eat vegetables and water, drink water, and see if God's going to, we're going to be pure to God. Would you have done that? You'd be like, it's over. It's over. The temple is gone. The walls of Jerusalem are burned down. We're sitting in a foreign land. It's over. Forget about convictions. Why do we need convictions? It's gone. But these people were still holding on to the key. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, that God has said the promise is coming. It's going to come. Are y'all seeing how to interpret with this key? You see the depth? What's the next and the last stage? The triumph of the promise. The post-exilic. I mean, these are prophets after the exile. Who are they? Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. Now, the last two are not prophets, but they, one is priest, one was a lay person, Ezra and Nehemiah. They come back to the promised land. But the temple, now y'all please listen, don't miss this. But the temple is not the real temple anymore. It's not Solomon's temple. It's Zerubbabel's temple. I mean, will God still bless us? There's nothing in the Holy of Holies. You knew that, right? It's gone. They've taken it. The Ark of the Covenant is all gone. So they're standing in front of the temple knowing that it's empty inside. Would you have still worshiped God? There's nothing here. What are we sacrificing to? promise is coming. It's not about the ark, it's about the promise. Folks, are y'all seeing this? How this is why I lean towards this key, which is the promised plan of God. This is the key that kept those people going. Yes, sir. Right. Right. Big picture. And sadly, many times Christians don't. I mean, we know some of these things. Don't get me wrong. I think I didn't teach you something brand new tonight. But I gave you something solid to hang on to, that if you're going to have a key, you better have a key that is solid. You cannot have a key that is, sometimes it is this and sometimes it is that, and a little tiny little phrase and a little book that was a bestseller, or this obscure verse in the Bible that really spoke to your heart, and now you read the Bible with that verse in mind. Okay, that's good, but you can't make that the key. The key has to be, remember the four criteria, the subject, the object, the link. It has to be in those chair passages. It's got to be something more than that. And then you apply it, and this is what you get. And then you break down the Old Testament in these various sections so that when you go back into the Old Testament, you go back with this key. And you not only get the big picture, but you have much more depth in what you're reading. The reason people say, I read the Bible, it's so boring to me, or I don't get it, is because there is no depth, there is no key, there is nothing. They're just, no wonder it's boring. Who wants to read about a bunch of people lived 3,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, and did stupid stuff? I mean, and God got angry at them. I mean, no wonder it's boring. Let's look at some test passages in the next maybe 10 minutes we have. Genesis 4:1. Now, which period are we in? You can just give me the number if you want to. Which? Pre-patriarchal era, which is the first, Genesis 4:1. All right, somebody read it for me and tell me what you think. Why? What's going on? Anybody? All right, Eve says something very strange. With the help of God, I have brought a man. What in the world is she talking about? And if y'all know, just say it. Just tell me. I'm sorry? God is the one who gives us life. The ultimate source of life. Do you think? Okay? What else do you see there in that statement? Right? Right. What was the last conversation they had with God? What did God say to Eve? The last conversation Adam and Eve had with God was that there's a seed coming through the woman. who is going to crush the head of the serpent. He is going to destroy the one who messed you up. Guess what Eve is saying? The one has come. The promise has come. Oops, it turned out to be Cain. That wasn't God's promise. I have acquired a man from the Lord. She didn't say, I got a man through my husband. He said, I got it from God. What she is thinking, the promise is now. I mean, won't you think that? You just sinned, and God says, your seed. She didn't realize the seed will come thousands of years later. And in fact, that very one actually became cursed. Right? What did Cain do? Killed his own brother. Wrong promise. All right? Sometimes I think, what could the application be? Our time is kind of short. What the application could be for today? What you may think, how many times have you heard people say that? I think this is God's will for me. I think God is speaking to me. Or I think God is saying, they all hold up the God card. I don't go for that. That to me is when somebody says, oh God, how do you know that? On what basis? Eve was just there with God, and she was wrong. Exodus 19, verse 5 and 6. All right, tell us, what do you think? What do you think is going on there? Based on the key, all right? We're putting the key there. All right, so what is, we're going back to what? The key. Right, right. And so what will happen? That's right. What era are we talking about? We're in the book of Exodus. It's a Mosaic era. All right? Go to 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 16. Now let's stop there for a second. Y'all can still find 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 16. Do you think everybody in Israel understood what God was saying? You are the kingdom of priests. What do you think they did? In Exodus 19, God tells them to be a kingdom of priests. And what do they do? What chapter is that? Yeah. Do you think they believed the promise was coming? I don't know what they believed what the promise was. All right, 2 Samuel 7:16. God, by the way, just to give you a context, God is speaking to David through Nathan the prophet. All right, what period are we in? The Davidic era. What do you think is going on here? Do you think David understood? I think he did. Your throne shall be established forever. David was smart enough to know that his kids, sooner or later, well, some of them, some great grandkid will mess up. What is the promise? Jesus is coming. Yeah. Proverbs chapter 10. What period does this fall in? Again, let me say one thing about these periods. There are no hard and fast rules as to which one falls under which. This is just the best way you can categorize them. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 27. All right, now you got the key. What is the key? God works first with the people of Israel, then with the whole world to be and to do something very special for them. The Messiah, the promised one, whatever you want to call it, Jesus is coming. How do you study this based on the key? Proverbs chapter 10, verse 27. Right. And will those days be just in this life, or is something more intended there? What is the more? That's right. It's eternal life. Now, how much more depth is that? Sometimes people say Proverbs are just like these, they're not really promises, they're just statements. Not true. It's much more to them. Okay? All right? 14:27. Proverbs 14:27. How does that apply with this key? Right. 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 And the promise is what? It's eternal life. Yeah. So this is not just fear God and you're going to have a fountain of life, you're going to live forever. No, this is something deeper. Solomon understood that. Right. I preached on Proverbs some a few years ago. Now maybe after I finish some of these series, I may go back to it because they have so much richness about daily life, but they also have the theological themes. I mean, so it's not just cut and dry. All right, let's go to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. This is going to be a hard one to find. Habakkuk chapter 2 and verse 4. All right. What era does the book of Habakkuk fall in? Renewal of the promise. Okay? So what is happening in the time of Habakkuk? Now, we don't know exactly the things that are happening, but overall we know that Babylonians will come against the people of Judah, and they're going to destroy them, take them away. All that's going to happen. How does this help us? Behold the proud. His soul is not upright in him, but the just shall live by his faith. Use the key. Now, these are tough passages. Gosh, I think my job is in jeopardy now. Y'all are doing pretty good. Yeah. Amen. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9 through 14. I don't know if you believe me or not, but what y'all are doing here, even Bible seminary trained students don't understand how to do this. You got a lot today. Very useful key. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9 through 14. Who wants to read it for us? Yes, sir.
Abidan,
right. Thank you for reading a long passage. Now here's the question. What period is this? Kingdom of the promise. Where are they? Where are they sitting? Where is Daniel right now? Is he in Israel? He's in Babylon. What's happened to Israel? What's happened to Jerusalem? It's destroyed. The temple, is the temple still there? Temple's gone. Everything's burned down. It's over. Guess what God does? Doesn't just tell him stuff. He actually gives him a vision of Jesus. That gives me chills just to think about that. He actually saw Jesus. And what did he say? How did it end? His dominion is an everlasting dominion. Means this one is not going to be just coming for a few minutes, a few days, a few years. He is coming for eternity. Wow. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. Let me quickly read that and we'll close. I just want y'all to get this, how beautiful this is once you understand. The last book in the Old Testament, the final word that God's going to give. How long is it going to be before Jesus actually comes from the book of Malachi? 400 some years. 400 years. Folks, 400 years, let's see, it's 2016. 400 years back is what, 1616? Right? The Jamestown colony just started. 1609, correct? That's y'all's history. Come on, help me. 1609, right? Okay. Malachi 3, 1 through 5. Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. How awesome is that? God tells him he's coming, he's coming. Someone is coming. Let me close with this. My challenge to you is understand this key. You have the notes in front of you. Go home, look it over, study it. And when you study the Bible, keep this key in mind. There's a promise God has given. First to whom? To Israel. And then to all the nations. And what's the promise? God's going to do something very powerful for them, which is what? Salvation. And his son is coming. His king is coming. And he will rule forever. And the people of God throughout the Old Testament. Next week, I think we have Bible school. But the week after, we're going to look at the New Testament Bible theology. Biblical theology. And put it all together. All right.